This is the Blaring Out with Eric Blair show, and today I'm pleased to have legendary singer of Suicidal Tendencies, Mike Muir, on the show. What unique events in your life or in your youth helped to establish your philosophy on life?
I think a lot is my dad. It's interesting too because you have kids now, when you're first going to have your kids, your friends all sit there and one, they assume it's going to be a boy, which all three are, but before you know, and you think about your dad and that type of thing, but everyone goes, oh, and as they get older, oh, they're going to be skaters. They're going to do music. My brother was a pro skateboarder. They're going to do this, this, and that. And my dad, had the philosophy that, he saw, as I call it, the Al Bundy people, the people that weren't happy with their lives and they want their kids to be what they, you know, live vicariously through them. And my dad always said, you know what, I want them to do something that they love and they feel is important and have a passion for it. That's not for me to decide, that's for them to decide and stuff. And as long as I'm able to give them enough exposure to the good things, and hopefully they'll find something that's good that they'll be proud of and stuff, and that's important. And I think that's the type of situation too many people try to follow or be steered into a certain path and they don't find their own path. And so I think that is part of the reason why, you know, my brother was a pro skateboarder, I reluctantly am a singer, and you know, my sisters have masters and things like that, so we all found our own little spot.
Why do you say reluctantly a singer?
Oh, I don't really you know, when it goes back to when we first started, a lot of people now, especially nowadays, you know, you get your Facebook page, you got your band logo, you got all your poses, you just don't have any music, you know. It's I want to be this, you know, and it's kind of like the 8-year-old, I want to be a doctor, I want to be a lawyer, you know, this and that, president, and they never become that and stuff. Those are just words and there's no conviction behind it. And to a certain degree, you talk to people all over, and you know, when you get them away from the whole, that breakdown of that facade, and go, well, what are you doing? What are you, well, you know, I'm kind of, oh, no. You get it. What are you doing? What do you want? Well, I kind of always wanted to do blah, blah, blah. And you're like, so what have you done about it? Oh, well, it's really hard. So you don't want to be then. No. I do. I want to, that's what I want to do. So what have you done about it? Oh, you know, it's really hard. And I mean, it's like this. So you don't want to be, you know, and it's interesting, that philosophy. And for me, one of my friends lived in an apartment with his mom and had drums, and they threatened to evict her because of the noise. So we said, you can put the drums where we live. And drums are kind of like something that anyone sees, that they have to hit the thing. Yeah. You know, you're not a drummer, but you just pound on it. And so we had them there, and one of our friends had guitars, and we used to have around parties, and we had a small backyard, and at the end of the month, we'd charge people to come in, and then we use the money to pay rent, and we had a small backyard, it was always full. We said, maybe let's play at the party, we'll scare everybody away, and then we'll get the second batch of people, we'll make more money. But it went the opposite way, they got really big, and then we started renting out halls and stuff. So for us, it was kind of just like, it was fun. It's kind of like I say, you know, you see the 45-year-olds playing soccer or basketball in the park, you know, they're 5'5". They don't think they're going to be in the NBA, but they're just having fun. And for us, that was kind of like, it was fun, you know, doing, you know, our version of what we thought punk rock was. You know, back then, there was no market for it. There was, you know, bands didn't sell. You couldn't sell, so you weren't thinking about that. So you're just doing something, you know, you skated, you went to the beach, you're doing music. So I never really wanted to be a singer, and I think that's probably why I'm still here.
Okay, so tell me how your older brother, Jim Muir, of the famous Dogtown skateboarding team, impacted your early passion for skateboarding and music.
Well, I think it's like two ways. A lot of times you see things as it happens, and then later on you look at it and you see it differently and stuff. I think one of the things with them is that back in the day, you know, it's like everybody's got their cameras on their phone, everything, you know, something happens and everybody's pulling and filming and stuff. And then you see people do something and they go look at it. Hey, maybe let's do it from another angle. And, you know, back in the day, if you had a camera, you were rich, you know, No one really had it. And when they were skating and doing things like that, they weren't doing it for the post in Facebook or for that reaction and that kind of stuff. They were doing it because that's something that they felt inside. And, you see that's to me and using a hyperbole, but that's a higher calling. You know what I mean? So many people, it's amazing how they are just more concerned how that post is going to be, and then the reactions to the post and stuff, rather than just going, wow, you know, doing it for themselves. And so being a part of that and them really redefining what skateboarding was, to the point that you got my son that like doesn't believe that all these things ever happened before, you know, and until someone does it, it's not possible. You know, when they first started skating pools, when they emptied out the water, it's like, this is the craziest idea. It's not possible. You're not supposed to skate in it. And as they first tried it and the people fell, everyone said, see, it can't be done. No, it just hadn't been done by the right people. And to me, it's like, my brother, you know, I was always looking up to him. He's 5 years older. And I was like, man, James, what's the problem? I keep falling. He goes, falling's not the problem. It's getting back up. That's the problem. And so that's skateboarding. But as I say, that's life. You know, we're all going to fall down, but you have to learn from it. And each time, you know, you fall, you get a little bit, okay, I see what I did wrong. Don't repeat the mistakes and give it a different approach. So I think that that kind of philosophy of doing things for yourself because you feel it's right, and not worrying about following somebody else's path, create your own kind of thing, is an important thing. And, you know, with my brother, when he was younger, everybody's, oh, you're wasting your time on that type of thing. And now, you know, he's got Dogtown skates and, you know, done all kinds of things. And I think people's inability to be able to see what you're doing has greatly held the world back in a lot of ways, because there's a lot of people that had great, great ideas. And there was way, all kinds of people very quick to tell them it couldn't be done. But the good thing is they didn't listen. And they let their effort and determination and their willpower and knowledge and everything determine where they ended up. And on the other side, I think there's probably a lot of great things that didn't happen because someone had an idea they probably could have had, and they let the doubt from other people saying they couldn't do it get in their way and stuff. So I think, you know, like I said, skateboarding, it's a small part of life, but a lot of things in life, you know, go together. And you know, there's a lot of symbolism there. You fall down, you get your ass back up, you know.
Describe your first skateboard.
Well, it's interesting because you didn't really have skate shops when I was a little kid. So my brother, actually, that's how the Dogtown skate started. They actually went out there and got the wood and made boards and tried to get different woods and experimented and all those processes, where now you got all the glossy boards and everything and stuff. But it took a lot of different, you know, they try to make their own plies and stuff, which was crazy at the time. Now they just have the machines and everything. You don't have the machines when they, you know, before, so someone has to come up with it. So my brother used to make the boards for us. You know, you start off with the Sears clay wheels, and the bearings falling out or getting wet, and you have to take them out and then clean each one and all that stuff. So it's come a long ways.
So no Kryptonics on your first skateboard?
Oh no, that was later. That was revolutionary and stuff, you know. And I guess it was the Chicago wheels were the first ones that were the kind of urethane ones that came through. And then, you know, Kryptonics was next generation and stuff. But I remember my brother actually got some of the Chicago, the first urethane ones, went out there and he's like, oh my gosh, it's like a Rolls Royce. You know what I mean? It was like, instead of being every rock. Yeah, it was. And those wheels don't compare and stuff. But yeah, that was crazy.
What was Santa Monica College like? Because you went there. How did that work for you?
Well, I only went to high school for a year and a half, and then I was in a car accident, and then I took the GED. But so I was going there when I was 16. But it was cool in a certain degree. But then you do music, and you can't really work your schedule around classes and stuff. But I was weird because I always liked school and stuff. So it's funny because I had an easy time with a lot of classes, but you have to have, for like your AA, you have to have an elective. And I tried to take a music class, and I took it 3 times and dropped out. I just couldn't handle it. Tried guitar, vocals, this and that. I just couldn't deal with it. But yeah, you know, it's interesting because I had a political science class, and the teacher kind of broke it down and stuff real quick and stuff. And I think, you know, junior college, there's a lot of times it's kind of like older babysitters and stuff. You know, it's kind of like, you know, some people are here. He goes, I already know who's going to do good in this class. And he goes, I know because I look at the ages. Because a lot of people here, they're not ready to go to college, or they don't want to, but they don't want to get a job or they don't want to move out, so they're just going here because that's the thing they do. He goes, but the older people, they went off, they did their thing, didn't work, and they're here for a reason. Yeah. So they go, usually that's the scores go, the older you are, the better you do, not because you're smarter, but you know why you're here. And he goes, that's anything in life, and it's very true. If you know why you're there, you're going to do much better. If you're just there, wherever you are, just to follow or look, not so much going to happen. But if you're there for a purpose, you know, the results show, the actions show. Oh, since my one sister, she went to back to college when she was middle 20s or whatever, and a lot of the people that she, you know, went and got out of high school and worked at a bank and got to the level where it was, and she saw a lot of people that were older that they're still at the same point, and it was pretty much that's all you can do. And she was thinking about going back to school, and someone said, oh man, if we would have done this when we were, you know, this, we would have this and that. And she realized after hearing three or four people do it, say that, you know, it's like, you're always gonna wish you could go back, you know, but with the point where you're here at now, saying you wish you could go back 5 years, 5 years from now, you're gonna say you wish you could exactly. Go to this point. Time just keeps moving, whether you're not, you are or not and stuff. And so I think that's one of the things is that too many people, they have an amazing ability to see the negatives and get those excuses rather than to sit there and go like dig in and say, okay, here we are, now let's make up for what we need to do and do it right this time.
Did you have any idea that your band Suicidal Tendencies would become a huge conduit for an entire gang of suicidals?
It depends on your definition, and I think that my dad always said is you can't communicate with people when you have different definitions, and so I think a lot of people have certain words and prejudices that don't apply to my definition, so you can't really have that conversation. But you know, it's always an excitement when people you know, really get excited about what you're doing. And, you know, you could look at a football game in Oklahoma in the Midwest, and there's a lot of people that get really excited, but they're not called a gang. But I think with Suicidal, there's a lot of people that I think that a lot of positive things have come through and with our music, and it's given them a lot of power to go off and have better lives. And I have, I call it the Santa Claus, big old boxes of letters from people that, you know, graduated, you know, all these different accomplishments in their life that they said that they wouldn't have happened if it wasn't for, you know, influence from the band and stuff. So I look at that and I say that's a good thing, and that's a good thing to be a part of.
But during the early Suicidal years, there was a lot of violence at the concerts, and a lot of people were claiming to be part of a Suicidal gang. Well, did you see that as a positive thing or a negative thing at the time?
The thing is that so many times that you can't talk about a lot of things because people talk about all the people that were killed, this and that, which never happened. And if it was, you'd be able to see about it. People talk about us being, you know, banned and problems, but if you look at the punk rock shows, people go to punk rock shows, break bathrooms and stuff. We didn't do those. We didn't get to play. There was the perceived threat, and that's why we were banned. There was never any incident that ever happened. It was because of the way that we looked in that type of situation. So we couldn't get the permits to play the larger places and stuff. And a lot of times when the promoters tried, then they got the little friendly call from the police or whoever saying not to, advising them not to do the show, that they'll be responsible if there's any problems. So a lot of people out of fear didn't do the shows and stuff. But there was never any incidences that it was, whereas you go to a lot of punk rock shows and there's a lot of things that happen. So when people say you can't be banned for no reason, there's a lot of things that, yeah, you can for no reason and stuff. It was the perceived that we were different and people were scared of that. So, you know, there was never any problems at our shows.
The riot at the Whiskey with Black Flag back in the day.
There was a week where there was three riots at Black Flag shows, but they were all police riots, you know? And there's a difference when something happens and when, you know, you're driving up four blocks away and you see a bunch of police cars and they're all getting the riot gear on. That's a police riot because there's no reason for them to be there. But when we, the first show that we did, we played it, when we couldn't do it, the promoter, Gary Tovar, from Golden Voice was real smart. He goes, man, you know, we try to do a show, there's going to be problems. He goes, if I got that, we'll play at the University of California, Irvine. He goes, Mike, the beautiful thing, state property, state police, no local jurisdiction. So when we did that show, did it on a Sunday night at the basketball court there. When you pulled in, literally the police were out there because they could not come on the campus. Wow. And so there was no problems at the show because there was no police. And when you have so many police committed to going to an event, especially back then, they're going to justify that. You know, they're going to harass people, they're going to do something, and they're going to create a problem. That's the way it used to be. And if that hurts anyone's feelings, so be it. But that's the truth, you know. So the fact that the police couldn't get there, there was absolutely no problems.
What do you consider your greatest achievement right now, Mike?
When it's all said and done, I hope to be a great dad, you know, and I think that's the most important thing. I think that that's a responsibility that, you know, for your family is very important and stuff, and, you know, to be a good, person, you know, and to be there for your family, and I think that's an important thing. If my kids say half as good things as I say about my dad, I think I did all right.
Yeah, you love your dad, because I've watched some interviews with you, and you quote your father a lot.
Yeah, my dad's coming down here tonight, so I'll try to make sure he doesn't get in trouble. No stage diving and that, but
that's cool.
Yeah, no.
Some bodyguards.
Yeah, got the kids, yeah, and all that. So, but yeah, no, I think very fortunate, you know, very happy.
Was there a time when you lived by the precepts of sex, drugs, and rock and roll? And if so, did it own you or did you own it?
I've never done any drugs, so... No, I think it's interesting. A lot of times, you know, you see someone and you don't know them. They're like, oh, dude, you're so lucky. And as I said, going back to my dad and definition, I said, yeah, why am I lucky? And they'll do, oh, you do this, blah, 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 this and that. And I'm going, well, basically you're saying you think if you were me, you would be an asshole and be able to get away with it. And I try not to be an asshole. A lot of people think I am because I tell the truth when it's easier sometimes. Oh, dude, cool, thanks a lot and stuff, you know. People get offended really easily, you know, for the simplest things. You know, it's like, dude, I'm buying you a beer. I don't drink, but thank you. And so, no, I'm buying you beer. I drink a beer with blah, 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 and I'm drinking a beer with you. And I go, I don't drink. And it's like, but I appreciate that. Oh, you're too good to drink a beer with me. I drink a beer with blah, 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 blah. And I'm not saying I'm too good to drink, but I'm not drinking a beer with you. There's nobody I'm drinking a beer with and stuff, you know. And who do you think you are? I think I'm the guy that's not drinking a beer with you. Yeah. That's what I think I am. But people get really offended with certain things and stuff. And a lot of times I think they see things that they don't want to see, you know, and they don't want us. So they somehow it's an issue they have with things. But, you know, I laugh at sometimes and this and that. But, you know, like I said, I look at my parents. They've been married 50 years. Wow. You know, very few of my friends I know, they are and stuff. And, you know, I think that's, to me, you know, what's success. I think success is being, you know, 95 years old, kicking it on the porch with your, you know, with your wife and stuff, and thinking she's still the prettiest person in the world. And, you know, your kids, you know, coming by and they still love you, you know? So I think that's important. So that thing never was a point to me and stuff. And there's, you know, going on music specifically, 99% of the stuff that I hear, I don't like. So I'm not concerned about what I don't like. I just do what I like. And I understand that a lot of people won't like it. And I really don't care, because I'm not doing it to be liked. And as my dad said, you know, when I was, you know, younger, he goes, the way most people get in trouble is trying to be liked, and they end up hating themselves because they're doing all the wrong things for other people that later on they'll realize was a waste of time, because those people don't matter.
How did the deal with Frontier Records come about?
I don't know. A friend knew them and stuff. And back in the day, you know, doing a record was, it didn't really matter. You know, you didn't, like I said, punk rock didn't sell. Bands bragged about selling a couple thousand records. So it was just, you know, something to do for fun, I guess.
And you did have a modicum of fame from the Institutionalized video on MTV. That's going to bring anybody fame, because that was huge back then. And that video inspired me to start a band, too. So did you embrace that fame?
I don't really think it was fame so much, because people didn't really know who you were and stuff. And I think at that time too, MTV was so small, but you know, there's a certain I guess excitement. I mean, I remember the first time that was got into my car and turn on the radio and you hear your song and you go to click out the cassette, but it's, you know, on the cassette, yeah. And there's no cassette in there and you're trying to wonder how it's being played without the cassette, and it's the radio station and stuff. And but there was always people that, you know, like Rodney on the Rock, there's always people that believed in it.
Because of that, you got to actually perform on an episode of Miami Vice in 1986. Was that fun for you?
I think it was earlier than that, but that was cool because it was kind of one of the ones the phone rang and it told people. I thought that it's like, oh, somebody trying to be funny, you know? Yeah, and Miami Vice at the time was like a huge show, and so it's like, yeah, okay, someone's trying to be funny and they're like doing this whole thing and then going to like, oh, we'll send the tickets out, you got to fly out tomorrow. Sure, sounds great. Yeah. And so went to the point that, wow, all of a sudden there's these tickets there. And so it was cool there, but it's the same thing. It was always somebody there that said, you know what, you know, love the band. And they did their little thing and got some people to go along with something that probably at the time was a little shocking, yeah, and stuff. So there's always been people. I've been very fortunate. I've met a lot of people that have kind of, instead of just taking the easy route, they stood up for me, stood up for the band. And you look back and it's kind of funny.
How did you guys find the capital to start Suicidal Records back in the day?
You don't, you know, it's kind of one of those things. You just, you know, you do what you do and you hope it'll work out, kind of thing. And you know, it's a whole different kind of situation than what a traditional record would be, kind of thing and stuff. So you go there, you go in after midnight, so you get in the studios as cheap as possible, you know you pull whatever strings you can and do that kind of thing, and you know, and you worry about it later.
How would you define the word love?
Love is a very complicated word. It's like a tree, you know, because a lot of things that people would say as positive, you would see as negative. But I think that love is honesty and choosing honesty for the right reasons. It's telling people sometimes what they don't want to hear because they need to hear it, you know. It's saying it in a way that it forces them to hear it, to go not just in the ear, but to kind of sit in their brain and rattle around till it hits their heart and stuff. I think love is the best thing, and a very difficult thing. But when things are done for the right reason, based upon love, the end result is really good.
Awesome. Okay, did you have any idea when you started Suicidal Tendencies that you would end up giving birth to skate punk, crossover thrash, and funk metal?
Nah, because it didn't really exist, and you know, I wasn't really worried about it. I think one of the things is it was just doing what I liked, you know. And as my dad said, if someone else does something you don't like it, you're twice as bad as doing that. So I didn't do what I didn't like. Didn't worry about people liked it. We didn't think anyone would like it anyhow. Weren't worried about the rules. And, you know, so when the first record came out, you know, all the punk fanzines said it was terrible. And then four years later, then it became a punk rock classic, and our second one was terrible. So, you know, that's just the way that it always goes when you do something differently. And people don't like that, you know.
I think the fact that after you came out with your first album, the fact that people were reaching out to you, you weren't reaching out to them. And as you said, with the whole Facebook generation, people are reaching out to, you know, the industry, whereas the industry, you know, in your day, they were reaching out to you. They saw something valuable in you.
Well, you know, in another degree, though, it was completely different because, you know, most of the record stores wouldn't carry the record because of the name. And when we first got approached to be the first two labels that approached us to sign us to a major, said, you know, we want to sign you, but you got to change the name, you know. And we're like, okay, thank you, have a good day. Yeah. And a lot of times people look at it like, you know, and I understand, they say it's business. If you can't get the records in the store, then people can't buy it. And I understand that. But, you know, there's more things to do in that. I mean, you can take it, keep going to different levels and putting more icing on the cake until, you know, on a brick. So it looks great, but it's, you know, it's a brick, you know.
Yeah.
So it's kind of one of those ones. It's like, you know what, that's not what the whole purpose is, and if it was, we'd be doing different music. And like I said, I'm more comfortable liking what I do than you know, having other people like it and me not like it, you know, and not like myself.
A few of the highlights of the Epic Records years for you.
I would have to say the Queensryche tour, and
that must have been vindicating for you.
Well, it was interesting because you know, Queensryche at the time was the most played band in America on MTV and the radio, and we were only going to supposed to do three shows, and started in Texas, and one of the journalists in the like Dallas Tribune or whatever, one of the big local paper, did a big article about how wrong it was that we were on the bill with Queensryche and this and that, and so they were kind of concerned, and their management's never seen anything like that, that a person would write an article and about previewing the concert and just going dogging us out and stuff, and just like they're going, do you know this person? I'm like, no. I mean, a lot of people, I don't know them, they can hate me, whatever. But so they were real concerned, and it went really good, and then they actually asked us to do a second leg. But you know, at the time our record had been out 9 months, we didn't have a video, we did 70 something shows, and we sold 150,000 more records. So who were we selling them to? We were selling them to people that were, you know, mainstream America, that, you know, 16, 18 years old. It's like, hey Debbie, Queensryche's playing, you want to go? And so it was a cool thing, because they just said, who's this band? Must be some new band, let's check it out, you know. And so many people, even to this day, you know, those young faces are older now, they said, first time I saw you was Queensryche, South Carolina, you know. So it ended up being a great not confidence, but you know, one of those ones, we always said the number one reason why people didn't like our music is they didn't hear it, you know. And so it was, that was a lot of fun, and it was a good tour. So on that sense, it was, yeah, kind of vindicating, so to speak, and stuff. I think you know, playing Irvine Meadows, which is a Verizon, you know, that was a cool thing and stuff.
What do you remember about the first time you met Robert Trujillo?
I always thought Robert was a really nice person, and I think that a lot of times nice people are not always great musicians. But he started playing the bass, slapping the bass and stuff, and I was like, "Oh, cool." And he goes, "Yeah, but I that's just my other thing." No, that's cool. And so it was the first time that, as the band progressed, you know, we got Mike Clark in there, and he filled out the rhythm and stuff. And, you know, Rocky, you know, we got him, he did the leads, and it was the first time Robert played the bass, where it's like, whoa, we're starting to sound like a band.
Yeah.
And, you know, you saw the reaction to other people you knew when he played. It was like, wow, it would enable us to go to a whole another level. And, you know, was definitely a great thing. So he was a massive influence, obviously, on the band, and it was in a good person too.
Why did it take 13 years for you to finally release a new Suicidal album called 13?
Well, it came to the point that it's 13 years, 2013, 13 new songs. It's a 13th record. 13's always been my lucky number. So a few years back, when people were asking, you know, jumping off, asking when the record's coming to come out, I said, I don't know, but if it goes more than 13 years, it definitely ain't gonna happen. So, but you know, we did the last record in 2000. You know, we toured for a while. You come back, went in the studio, recorded 15 songs, and then we said, why are we doing this? You know, that's a pattern rather than like a statement. And so we said, you know, let's, you know, go and write some more songs. And then we were touring, I had a first back surgery, and so that kind of put things back. The other thing that really set us back was that we got a you know, Pro Tools studio, like so many people, and that enabled us to be able to go in at any time. And when you can go in at any time, you find it like, oh wow, this is cool. love doing music, so you're doing music because you love it, and you're not sitting there where you go, okay, we got 2 months this time off, so we have to write the record, and then we got to go in the studio, and that's got to be out for this release date. And then as the record business, you know, was destroying and stuff, it made it easier to not do a record too, which is good for us too, and more the way when it started. So, you know, we ended up recording so many songs, and you record so many songs, and you get to 200 songs, then it's kind of like, what's the record, you know, kind of thing. And then it gets to the end of the point, like I said, where, you know, everybody, things happen in life also, you know, people losing family members, people having new family members, you know, kids, things like that, and a lot of situations. So it had to be the right time, and from last year, what we thought was going to be the record, to what we ended up in, even in the studio, to January this year, you know. So it was a process, and a good process.
Now you've taken on the moniker sometimes of Cyco Mike. You've done solo records as Cyco Mike, but sitting here talking with you, is Cyco Mike, you don't seem like a psycho to me. Now, I know we all have that potential as a human being to get psycho, get us behind the wheel of the car on the 405 at 5 o'clock, but is that a persona that you portray, or is there a part of you that is Cyco Mike?
I don't think it's a persona. I think it's the definition. You know, we, like we said, psycho with the C, and you know, most people choose to put on blinders, you know, they have them on there, or they close their eyes, I didn't see it, you know, they want to have the built-in excuses. You know, I always said, you know, what psycho with a C is like when you're crazy enough to actually see what's out there, even if it's not what you want it to be, you know, but that's what you need to see, so you know what you're dealing with, so you can take care of the situation and handle things and stuff. You know, I think people don't believe in themselves. I think that's, you know, it's unfortunate that the people that truly do, you'd consider them crazy, you know, because the majority of people don't believe in themselves. Majority of people are waiting to follow somebody else and stuff. We're not telling people, you know, we don't want people to try to get people to follow them, but we want them to be able to follow their path that they need to go and stuff, not for other people, but for themselves and stuff. So I think, yeah, it's crazy to believe in yourself. You know what I mean? I think it's crazy to stand up for yourself. It's a lot easier to be a coward, or, you know, like I said, put on those, well, I didn't know, you know, this and that. And so for us, it's like, hey, you know what? When you know what you're doing, you know there's a good reason for it, you've done it, you know, you're prepared for it, and you do it, then people can call you crazy. And it's, to me, that's the craziest thing in the world, you know? So I think, like Cyco, like I said, that's a very positive thing, you know? It's like suicidal, that's a very positive, you know, kind of thing for us. It means, like, I always say, like with the Olympics, you know, Winter Olympics, if you put me on skis and have me go off, I've never skied in my life, and go down one of those alpine, you know, jump things or whatever, that'd be crazy. I've never done it. But for me to say people can't do that, people that have trained all their lives and done that, I think a lot of times people, it's easier to say, oh, you can't do that, you can't. No, the person that's saying that can't do that, that doesn't mean you can't do that. So it's, what is crazy? I think you need to reevaluate that. What is suicidal? For me to try to jump from one building to another for no other reason than to just to see if I can, well, that's stupid, you know what I mean? But when you're doing something for a reason, a purpose, whether other people understand that, then there's a whole different reason to that, and a level and stuff. So for us, it's like, you know what? Sometimes you gotta get a little crazy, you know what I mean? Because most people, they're gonna go whimper off and back away. You know, you gotta stand up for yourself.
Are you a spiritual person?
Same thing, definitions. Everyone has different definitions, but you know, I believe, well, it's like, you know, the Latin word religioso, it means way of life. And I think that's goes back to what my dad said. He goes, I don't care where you go on Sunday, but if it helps you live a better life Monday through Saturday, good. You know what I mean? If it helps you feel better about all the bad things you do, then bad, you know? And so I look at things and stuff. I believe there's a lot of purposes, a lot of things that we won't understand at the moment that sometimes we do later. I think there's a lot of things we don't understand because we choose not to understand. But there's things I think that are undeniable. And I think good is good. And that's something that a definition that we shouldn't try to alter.
Do you believe in a higher power?
I believe when people do things for the right reason, it is a higher power. And I think that that's something that is not taught or learned. I think that's something that's is planted within us, and then we choose whether to water it or not.
what inspired the lyrics for the songs on 13, and the songs I'm going to ask you about are, the first one is God Only Knows Who I Am.
Well, I think that's one of the ones where sometimes people spend too much of their life trying to explain things to other people, and sometimes they fall in that trap, realizing that people won't understand who it is. I think there's an importance to sit there and not try to use your intelligence to justify, or this is my dad says, when we get older, we use our intelligence to try to manipulate things to make it fit right so it sounds good. And as long as it sounds good, then it's okay. But there's a point where you have to have a purpose and an understanding in your life, and that comfortableness with yourself, not to accept what it shouldn't be, but to sit there and to move forward and stuff. And there's a lot of things, if I had to explain everything that I was doing, I'd never get anything done. There would be people that never understand, and they won't, and they shouldn't. And you know, I think there's a point where you have to be honest, where, you know, however you look at God or what it is and stuff, you can't lie. There's an honesty there, implied honesty. You can't lie to, you can lie to everybody, you can lie to yourself, but I don't think you can lie to God or that whoever you put that person, there's something or figure or that type of situation. Someone has to have something where it's like the truth, just you can't do that lying and stuff. And I think that's a very important thing. And when you start from that point, then you're going to go forward.
Well, we live in a world today where some people don't have consciences, so they never move forward.
I think that's part of the thing. You have to have something that, you know, whether it's your kids, whether it's something, there has to be something that sits there that should put you on a higher level of responsibility not self-righteousness, because that's a whole different negative thing, but it should be should be righteous, yeah, you know, yeah. In the sense not of putting yourself above other people. But I always say it's important to put yourself in a position where you understand what's important so you can help the person that needs help, you know, rather than just go out there and, you know, misinterpret, in my opinion, the Bible, where it says, for if you've done it under the least, so you go to the people that don't want to have help, so you think somehow God's going to bless you because you're trying to help all the people that don't want it, that are just not going to do any good, rather than the one person that just needs a hand, instead of just, you know, going to pull you down, is going to get up, and they're going to look for the opportunity to help somebody else because they'll remember where they came from.
Till my last breath.
I think that's one of the things. It's about being, you know, the same thing is being strong in who you are and stuff, you know. There's a lot of people that are constantly wavering. They're looking different ideologies, this and that. They're waiting for someone else to take care of all their answers and this type of thing and stuff. I think when you feel what you are, you know, who you are, and you and confident and stuff, you live your life a certain way and stuff, you know. And my dad said, you know, a tangent of what I said before, you know, hell is when you're, you know, 80 years old, 90 years old in a rocking chair and you can't do anything, and you're thinking about all the things the way you wished you would have done them. Yeah. And you're having that conversation with yourself and going, why did you do this to me, this and that. So I think that when you get that to that kind of point, you sit there, and it's funny because on TV, you know, the cartoons, they have the little angel, and the angel's like, didn't you? Oh, that's wrong. And then you got the devil. What's the matter? You scared? And my dad said, you know what? Little angel should be the one that's like going, you dumb mother. What the hell? Why would you do something like that, you know? And being like, you know, the stronger person and stuff that sits there and go, dude, are you? No, don't. You're not going to do that. No way. And so I think it's all perception. And so to my last breath, it's that perception. It's like, you know, it's that fighting spirit. You know what I mean? And you know, not taking the easy way, taking the right way.
Well, with that, Mike Muir, thank you so much for being on the Blaring Out with Eric Blair show. Blaring Out with Eric Blair with Mike Muir of Suicidal Tendencies, signing off.
Suicidal.
The Blaring Out show.